talk about the future roadmap of BizTalk. So the way it's going to be structured is we first talk about the release cadence and talk about how and the cadence in which you're going to ship, and then move along to what we shipped this year, which is BizTalk Server 2013, and what has happened between the time we shipped in March and today. Talk about everything that's happened until now, and then talk about HIS. Paul and Jorge from HIS is here to talk about it. And then we'll finally talk about the future of BizTalk and what we currently have in plan, as well as something which we want to do like 2 years down the line. All right? To start off, we're going to talk, you introduce, all right? To start off, we'll talk with the release cadence. Vivek today talked in the keynote and said that we are going to have an incremental release wherein we do a major release every 2 years and a minor release every 2 years. So it will alternate between a major release and a minor release. BizTalk Server 2013 was a major release, so you'll expect a minor release next year. And currently that is going to be what we currently call as BizTalk Server 2013 R2. And we plan to do that in H1 of next year. And then the cycle continues. We'll again have a major release and then a minor release. The difference here is in minor release, we are looking at platform adoption and then making sure that we do select specific themes and go after the features in those themes. In a major release, we'll go after most of the customer has all the big features and big scenarios which you want to address. So at any of these stuff, whether it's a major release or a minor release, it's going to be fully supported by Microsoft. It's just like any other cycle. You'll have a CU, you'll have a support, and everything remains the same. And given the nature of it, we'll be adding new features or fixing bugs, et cetera. It won't affect any of this, any of the things which we already have. So we will always provide back compat. So taking your investments forward should never be an issue. So we'll make sure that we do support and provide the migration path as we always do. And what I'll quickly talk about, I won't spend a lot of time in this slide because we have talked about it earlier in tech ed and other venues. I'll just quickly highlight some of the things in 2013 where the themes are. We did support all the latest platforms and standards across multiple things, and we did a lot of things across manageability, performance, and performance is a key thing, and we'll talk about it later in the session as well. And the one of the major things which was unique to 2013 release was the fact that we could now run it in the cloud. So BizTalk Server 2013 is now available in IIS as well. So you can go to Windows Azure and spin up a new VM and start creating your BizTalk machine and get started with it. So what I'll do is quickly talk about some of the features and not go into the demo part of it, but talk about what we thought through when we created this feature in the first place, right? And how we think this feature would be helpful and how to rationalize it. Let's take the notion of dependency tracking. This was in 2013. And the reason is in BizTalk Server, you have multiple artifacts. You have the notion of, in this case, let me take the example of, you have a send port which has a pipeline on, and it has a map, and the maps are schemas, et cetera. The forward dependencies is always clear, saying that a send port has a pipeline, a send port has a map, and the map has a schema, it works on a schema, et cetera. The thing where it becomes really complex, if you try to do the reverse thing, saying that if I have a pipeline, tell me the list of ports in which it's present, or if I have a map, tell me the list of ports in which the map is used, et cetera. So those sort of reverse decisions were never clear. So things like if you want to update a schema and see, do a check saying that if I update the schema, which all artifacts will get impacted? What should I know about it? So that sort of decision making or impact analysis was not clear in previous versions. So what we did was we provided bidirectional dependency checks. So the way you should think about it is there are two kinds of relationship. One is users, where a send port uses a pipeline, a send port uses map, et cetera. And there is also the other reverse direction where a schema is used by a map is used by a pod, and a pipeline is used by a pod, et cetera. So when we designed dependency tracking, it was primarily with the intent saying that anything you want to do an impact analysis on, you should be able to go and do it. If I'm a developer and I have a custom pipeline and I make a modification to the custom pipeline and deploy it, you need to know where all will it get impacted. You might have to create like new binding files, new deployment scripts, et cetera. So you need to know where all it gets impacted. And that's one of the reasons why we did dependency tracking. And the one caveat in dependency tracking is that the way it is implemented today in 2013, it is only tied to static types. For example, in your orchestration, if you have a map, you won't be able to say this map has a dependency on that particular orchestration as well. But for all these static types, like ports and everything you see in the BizTalk admin console, you should be able to go ahead and view the dependencies in the admin console itself. The second aspect which I'd like to talk about is the SharePoint experience. Just a quick check, how many of you have done a connection to a SharePoint in BizTalk 2010 or earlier, right? And how many of you spend a lot of time trying to get the things right? You have to install the SharePoint adapter servers and get everything in place. So what we did with SharePoint 2030 is that we added the support for client-side object model. What it allows you to do is, if you're a client, irrespective of where the SharePoint is located, as long as you can get access to it, you should be able to go ahead and connect to it. So there won't be any more dependency. So you can now just go to BizTalk server, use the out-of-the-box SharePoint adapter, and then say, go and connect to your SharePoint 2010, 2013, SharePoint online, or any SharePoint server, and you won't have any dependencies at all. So you just go ahead and connect. So this is one of the things we did. And the key thing to note is, if you still have the dependencies like earlier, you can still have the server-side object model. It's just that we have added support for client-side object model and made it the default behavior. So today, if you want to connect to a SharePoint server which has like SharePoint form which has 15 nodes or 100 nodes, you won't have any of the dependencies on the SharePoint nodes at all. You can just connect from your BizTalk server without any dependencies. And that was one of the key things when we thought through saying that this is a harder problem to solve, and it's one of the most consistent feedbacks which came to us since 2010 when we started looking at it. And again, the whole thing is, and we have talked to people who connect to SharePoint forms as opposed to individual SharePoint nodes, and they were really happy when we released this feature in 2013. And the other part which came as a side effect and when we designed through it was Office 365 was coming up, and we wanted to make sure that we support it natively. So in 2013, if you go ahead and say if you're connecting to your Office 365 document library, there's a very clean way of saying how do you connect to it, and you can provide the authentication mechanism for it. So overall, what we have in terms of SharePoint is a much more streamlined experience, and hopefully, if there are any feedback, please feel free to reach out to me. And the third major thing, and this is one of the things which caught a lot of people's attention, was our implementation of REST. There are good parts to it and bad parts to it. I'll talk about both of it. When we did the REST implementation, BizTalk server, until that point in time, you can natively do HTTP POST using HTTP adapter, but some of the more important semantics, like how do you do proper REST, either in terms of consuming services or exposing services, it was not very clear. So what we did was, irrespective of what your intention is, whether it's exposing REST services or consuming existing REST services, we wanted to provide a neat platform play out of the box. So if you want to do HTTP put, get, delete, et cetera, any HTTP verb for that matter, it should be possible. And the thing which we did is very, very similar to the way we expose SOAP. In BizTalk, we have a list of operations which you can expose, and for each operation, you can say what the method is and what the URI is. The key difference here is that we introduce a notion of what we call as variable mapping. So typically, when you expose REST services, you might say, get me slash orders slash the order ID. And in most cases, that order ID will come from your business requirements. So you won't be statically hard coding in your URL to say /order ID /5. So the way we want to model it is such that based on your business process, when the data flows through BizTalk, you should be able to model what the outgoing variable mapping is, and hence the name. It's straightforward. So the way we do it is we provide a placeholder, and the placeholder specifies the value which comes at runtime. And that placeholder is in turn provided at runtime by property schema values. And for example, this is an example where you expose a local web service, and when you expose a web service, you can specify these are the two endpoints I want to expose. And the second endpoint, you're saying that whenever a client sends a message and gives this particular ID, we will in turn consume it and then populate the property schema. So it acts both ways. When you're sending a message out, you take it from your runtime and then send it out. When you're exposing a web service, your client sends the message, and based on the message you get, you populate the property schema. So, and this coupled with the implications of having the REST adapter is slightly more, because it now allows you to create and expose services without having a dependency on any model, be it SOAP or WCF and things like that. It allows for interop, which is really good. And the third part of the features which I want to highlight is around service bus. And service bus provides this brokered messaging capabilities as well as relay capability, which allows you to take your first step to the cloud or expose your existing processes to the cloud. So what we did was we wanted to make sure we support natively the service bus objects, and these includes queues, topics, and relays. So we have introduced two adapters, one for messaging, which is called SB messaging, and other for relays. It is WCF basic HTTP and as well as NET TCP relay binding. We support all three formats of it. And the good part about it is brokered message as its own implementation, where you have a message body as well as a set of headers. And when we consume the data from service bus into BizTalk, you won't lose any message at all. So even if you have data in the brokered message properties, you'd be able to convert them to BizTalk's context properties. So we provide full parity between service bus message and a BizTalk message coming into the system. And we also support authentication, so in the sense that you don't have to go ahead and provide the ACS configuration explicitly. Service bus supports a whole ton of authentication mechanisms. It started with ACS, then they had other token providers like support for AAD and other stuff. So we are going to go ahead and do it in the next versions of BizTalk. And then one of the other key things which came into play for BizTalk Server 2013 was our focus on performance. So in this case, there are two things which led to the performance improvements. One was we moved from the mapping engine internally uses an API. We switched that API so that we get improved performance. So you as a user, when you do your messaging scenarios and you move from BizTalk Server 2010 or earlier and move to 2013, you will see improvements directly out of the box. You don't have to do anything. It's already baked into the runtime. And this is something we call as XSL compile transform, but that's a property of the mapping engine itself. So what you see in the screen is one of the tests which we did in our labs, and we'll be publishing the paper soon, where we consider all sorts of variations for messaging plus long running, a single BizTalk scenario or a single BizTalk plus multiple message boxes or multiple message box scenarios. In all these cases, what we found consistently was on messaging scenarios, we found at least 40% consistent increase in performance, and that might differ from implementation to implementation, but that's a percentage which we got as part of our test runs which we did. And the other part which we did for performance improvements is regarding the ordered send port scenarios, where we changed and tweak some of the things at runtime, where if we use ordered send ports and do it in 2013, you will inherently get performance improvements. And again, both these performance improvements are inherent, so you don't have to go and tweak any host settings or any registry files. It comes as part of the platform. And then I quickly want to talk a bit about adoption and and how we went through it. And this dates back even before we released BizTalk Server 2013. As with any BizTalk release, we run a tap program where we go and ask customers to come and participate, get early bits, work on it, give feedback, et cetera. We had a whole bunch of people who who participated in the BizTalk Server tap program for 2013. And as part of them, at least like 10 to 15 people went live when we went live. So that is one major channel for our adoption scenarios. And as part of it, we had a healthcare provider who worked with us from, I believe, CTP or beta, and went all the way live when we went live in March. And they have been extremely successful with their implementation. So they did their implementation in March for the regional integration scenarios. They're a healthcare provider based out of US, and they also have a foray in Canada. And they have been really happy with the healthcare improvements, the performance improvements, and taking the decision to bet on 2013. The other set of customers whom I want to talk about is people who bet on BizTalk Server 2013 because of the features we built on BizTalk Server 2013. So in this case, one example is a mining company who want to order parts, and the company who fulfill that orders, they in turn send the messages later at a later point in time once all the orders has been fulfilled. And this is done through REST semantics. So using BizTalk Server 2013, they built the solution, and they can now connect directly instead of having like custom code and message inspector implementation, et cetera. And the same company, they also have the notion of, they bet on SFTP, because when you saw the first slide, some of the new things which we did, like REST, SFTP, cloud enablement, service bus, et cetera, these are useful to a lot of people because they don't have to do things out of the box. They don't have to do things explicitly, right? And then I just quickly want to talk about some other things which we have heard from you as feedback since we released 2013. And these include, like, for example, in SFTP, the current implementation did not allow proxy support or did not allow SSO support. And those were things which became a bottleneck for some of our customers. So, and I'll talk at a later point in time in terms of how we plan to address some of these things. And in terms of REST, this is the bad part of REST implementation which we had in 2013, which is even though we provided REST, we didn't natively support JSON, where people had to go and write custom components to go and enable JSON support. And this is a very, very major feedback and a valid one as well. So we are looking at implementing it in the next minor version of BizTalk, which is 2013 R2. And along with Service Bus, today, Service Bus, we strictly tie to ACS, but there are other modes of authentication to ACS and other token providers, as well as support for Service Bus on Windows Server. So these are things we are looking at, and hopefully we'll be doing it in the next minor release. The final thing around ESB Toolkit was we released 2013, and there were a bunch of issues with ESB Toolkit and caused a bunch of problems. So it's specifically tied around BRA resolver and SSO configuration in ESB Toolkit. I'll also, when I switch back and come back later, I'll talk about how we plan to address these feedback. And in this slide, I also quickly want to talk about saying that people always think about the major release when you talk about BizTalk Server 2013, BizTalk Server 2010, or the next version of BizTalk. They seem like big announcements. So what we also want to talk about is quickly talk about what have we done since BizTalk Server 2013 release in March until now. And the first thing is we released a CU1 for BizTalk Server like within a week of BizTalk Server release, and then made it automatically available to everyone through Microsoft Update. One of the primary reasons we did that was to make sure we consider the fixes which went to the CU as something which is critical for all customers. So we entered and did that release within a week. And then Paul is going to talk about HIS in the coming minutes, and HIS was released as well. And we did a bunch of updates around Swift Message Pack. This is something we do year in and year out, and we did it after we released in 2013, as well as we have Drummond certification for the B2B platform. And recently, I think it's just like 2-3 weeks before, we released the BizTalk Server 2013 CE2, and it contains a bunch of fixes, and it addresses the ESB issues, which was highlighted earlier. And also, right now, I think from today, you'll be able to access BizTalk Server 2013 Developer Edition in, that'll be on top. So the image, but the difference is we'll be creating a developer edition image in Azure IS Gallery, and that will come with the CU2, right? So, and this time, the developer edition came at a later point in time. There was a delay of about 5 to 6 months to get this particular SKU released, but this is a one-off thing, but going forward, when you release 2013 R2 or other versions of BizTalk, we don't expect the same thing to happen. So what I'll do at this time is quickly switch and give the control to Paul. We'll talk about HIS.
Cool. Thanks for John.
You want the control?
Yeah. Lovely click boxes. So bad news, good news. Bad news, we started late. Sorry about that. Thought that we started at 3 and we were really trying to get connectivity. The other bad news is our really cool mainframe to cloud demo. We can't get to. But the good news is we have less demos and we'll fit right in the time remaining, okay? Something like that. So you can think, how many people are familiar with IBM heritage, legacy, existing systems? Yeah, any customers with IBM systems? 1, 2, 3, okay, all right. So if I say legacy, it's because the majority of people look at them as legacy. Thing is, our enterprise customers have made significant investments in IBM heritage systems, IBM mainframe, mid-range systems, anywhere that they run server software like WebSphere, MQ, DB2, and Informix. And for a long time, longer than I'm working at Microsoft, Microsoft has realized that value their customers have in these existing non-Microsoft systems and have connected to them, integrated them, interoped with them through various standards. And so host integration server has been around for a while. It's licensed technology, it's supplemental to BizTalk, and a little teeny part is also supplemental to SQL. It's useful to know a little bit about it. Even if you're an end customer organization, you don't have IBM systems. Maybe you have some friends that do. And then certainly for our partners in the audience and some of the Microsoft people that are here, I want to cover this pretty quickly, I think. So one way to look at this is that in the middle, we have this thing called host integration server. It's a set of technologies and tools. It allows for hybrid Azure workloads, and we'll talk about a customer doing that today, Windows desktops, devices like ATMs, cash registers, that sort of thing. And then, of course, Windows servers like BizTalk and SQL and anything in .NET, SharePoint, connect up to IBM systems. Whether the back-end system is the big box, little boxes, it doesn't matter. And we do that primarily through IBM proprietary protocols and formats. And we've devised those protocols. Sometimes we've licensed them from IBM. And there's a couple of industry standards as well, for example, to get to the databases. What's new in the 2013 release? Well, one thing that's new is it shipped late. I apologize for that as well. Not only do we start sessions late, we ship late too. We shipped about 5 months late at BizTalk, and it's primarily due to the fact that we had a very rich rapid deployment technology adoption program, which we started almost as soon as we shipped HIS 2010, 3 and some years ago. We started a project up to enable customers to migrate off of mainframe, DB2 and CICS, and run it in .NET and SQL. And we started working on some really cool new technology for that. And we got a couple of TAP sites interested very early. And we got deep into working with those TAP sites. Got a couple of them deployed in production. And it really consumed up the 20-person team that does HIS. And it caused us to miss the train for BizTalk. So we shipped about 5 months late. The good news is, bad news, good news, is that we actually support the latest operating systems, Windows 8.1, Windows Server 2012 R2. We actually support SQL Server 2014 as well. There's nothing in our technology that didn't test well with that, so there's no code changes in SQL or HIS to support that. It's not listed here, though. It's not in our release notes and install guide. We'll add that shortly. And the only thing really missing from this list is the new Visual Studio, and we'll talk about how we'll support that in a bit. We introduced a couple of new connectors. We connect out from a Windows client to Informix databases. Turns out that the same DB2 protocol is now supported by Informix 10.5 and later. So we have an old ADB provider for Informix, and we'll talk about how we're going to fill that out with more connectors later, like BizTalk. And then we also did this cool new thing for migration. It's called the DB2 client connecting to SQL Server, or DIR to service. It's effectively a gateway that sits on the SQL box with an in-memory connection to SQL, or on the network clustered in front of SQL servers, whether the SQL servers themselves are clustered or mirrored. It allows for any DB2 client, Java client running in Linux, mainframe, COBOL, CICS, you name it, to connect into SQL Server as if it's DB2. We map and authenticate the foreign credentials to AD. We convert the data types, of course, the encodings, the transactions, and it's really, really cool stuff. And it performs very, very well, but it took a long time to deliver it. Also, for those familiar with the technology, and I see some of our partners in the audience, John, how's it going over there? A few of the people. We've pretty much gone all .NET, except for in our old legacy SNA gateway and client. Everything else is almost all .NET now, all the way down to the wire. One of the exceptions is the DIRTA client for DB2 and Informix. That's still unmanaged. And then, of course, things like COMMODB and ODBC. And then, one other thing that's not managed is our MQ connectivity. We rely upon an IBM footprint there, so that's unmanaged code. But everything else we pretty much replumb so it's managed code. It uses XML for schemas, much like the BizTalk adapters do. Very modern WebCF-enabled technologies for connecting into the transaction programs, into the databases, the file systems, and into the screens with Session Integrator. And we also introduced a new TN3070 emulator, although you like to think that customers aren't doing terminal emulation anymore. They actually are. You go into Home Depot. You go into Costco, certainly a lot of airline reservation systems, you can still see the terminal emulators right there. In fact, inside Costco, you can actually walk up to terminal emulators in their customer support table and use it yourself. These emulators are around out there still, and so we introduced a new mainframe emulator with file transfer, keyboard, macros, the whole shebang. Lastly, performance and scalability. Because we're dealing with enterprise solutions, we have to have real high scale and perf. And we've increased the connectivity to DB2 on the push side, so we can push rows into DB2 faster than ever. And that's really a testament to the fact that the information of record has moved somewhat from only being on the back-end system to being in SQL now. And so we have to get the new information, the new orders, the new customers, the new service information back into the legacy systems for processing. So that's really cool, encouraging. Mention a customer very quickly here. You can read the slide later. One of the more modern European banks based in Luxembourg, BCEE, they're known for their internet banking. They're also one of the most secure banks in the world, have a pointer to their website that can attest to that. Their ATMs are running Windows, recent Windows 7 OS, really cool. They have Surface 2 tables in all their branches running Windows, of course. And all of this connects through a middle tier combination of web services, which are migrated WCF services, ASP.NET applications for DB2, and BizTalk as a service bus to orchestrate these web services, connecting back into CICS in the mainframe and also directly into DB2. So pretty high scale for a relatively small bank, fast response time, and quite a few transactions per day, about 8 million for kicks and 6 million directly into DB2. And I wanted to point this customer out because they're very useful if you're trying to advocate for BizTalk HIS technology inside your organization or inside one of your customers' organizations. Steve Milan, the key architect with whom we work, we meet with him every other week via link, is also one of our MVPs, and he will do customer-to-customer briefings for you. They use every technology in HIS and a lot of BizTalk, so a good resource for you to know about. Looking a little bit closer at the DB2 connectivity, the new thing is on the right side of the diagram, and that's where we go from anything DB2, like the mainframe, into DIRTA service. Good news is that we're not going to spend much more time talking about it because we have the demo, but you know, I think we'll do a webcast one of these days, okay? So you can log in and see it's pretty cool stuff. It effectively makes SQL Server look with a compatibility layer just like DB2 on the wire, and with a bit of work over the next couple years, Informix as well, I should think. So we won't do that demo. Another customer, another reason why we were delayed is this time last year we got a call from MCS in Mexico and they said, hey, we've got a deployment. It's a really cool high-scale Azure hybrid deployment where the government of Mexico has a standard for electronic invoicing. So all of the invoices throughout the government and in the commercial world have to go through government clearinghouse, through the IRS, the SAT down in Mexico. And we're running into some problems. There's so many transactions coming every day, and the transactions in the form of XML invoice documents that get stored in blob storage on the mainframe, get pulled down by WCF services into SQL, stored natively as XML and SQL. The WCF adapter for SQL pulls it out into BizTalk, and then transactionally push those up through the BizTalk adapter for DB2 into the mainframe DB2 for ZOS. And a couple of problems they're running into. One is they needed to store it as native XML, and we didn't support that at the time. So quick, couple of weeks, we implemented support for XML in our HS 2013 rapid deployment program. And then what was worse when they went into production is they couldn't quite meet the scale they needed. They were doing about 3 million invoices per day, but they needed to push that up to 10 to 12 million per day. And we just simply couldn't get data into DB2 fast enough. So we re-engineered the BizTalk adapter for DB2 to support something we call bulk insert. In our underlying 80 net provider, you might be familiar with the SQL client bulk copy. It allows you to take an array of values in on a data reader and then send those out in terms of a batch insert. How it works with DB2 is you create one insert statement. We do that automatically under the covers within our 80 net provider. And then we send that SQL command down for the insert statement to DB2, set the parameters, and then we send an array of values that can just span multiple 32K buffers across the wire. It's very fast. And I was going to show you a demo of that. If you don't use this bulk copy, bulk insert, you effectively have to set a command statement, set the parameters, that's two flows, send the data across in 32K bunches, and it's really, really slow. So we're getting 10x to 25x improvement in performance, and that was enough to help Mexico go live. Pretty cool stuff. Of course, now if you look at this, you go, why aren't we using BizTalk services, right? Well, it wasn't available last year. We'll get around to that, I hope. Okay, good news. We're going to show that demo.
You're one slide behind on the main screen.
Sorry?
You're one slide behind on the main screen.
Okay, I'm looking at my own screen here. Right, so what have we done since 2013? Yeah, it was only a couple of months ago. Give me a break. We actually shipped an update to our software development kit. It's in beta testing right now, so we've revamped our SDK, modernized all the sample applications, made sure they were secure, I mean the coding guidelines that we have at Microsoft to ship SDK samples. We have been working on this one small thing we don't support. So if you look at BizTalk 2013, there's a few platform holes. If you look at HS 2013, there's just one. It's Visual Studio 2013. And we're working on a hot fix that will release in HS 2013 Cumulative Update 1 this next quarter. And that'll allow us to patch and help customers use Visual Studio 2013 with HS 2013. And then we're also spending a lot of time since shipping, still are today, working with the SQL 14 team on getting our supplemental technology in the feature pack for SQL Server 2014. That's where we give away our DB2 client for free. Good stuff. Beyond that, we're looking down the road. We're looking when the next major is, okay? So we just did a major in HS 2013, that's version 9. We don't need a minor, kind of missed that boat, because we've been working, it took us a while to ship, and we only have one small hole. So we're actually focused on the next major release, and that's our version 10. And there's not a lot on the slide, so that's good news. That means that you as customers, partners, and Microsoft can give us some input on what you'd like to see. Certainly, we'll have an opportunity to sync up the platforms again. What's new from IBM, what's new from Microsoft, certify those things work well together. And then also Informix. It's a big opportunity for us. We get to it relatively free, because we simply cloned our DB2 client, our DIRTA application requester, our protocol client, and we made some changes to support DRDA as supported by Informix version 10.5 and later. And now we can layer on top of that separately OLEDB, which we have today, ADO.net, which we just are completing, we're at DevCon complete right now, and then a BizTalk adapter for Informix, which Jorge will show us here in a moment. Also, one of the themes will be deployment. Installing and configuring the product and technologies using PowerShell, administering the systems using PowerShell. We have some of that in the release today, but certainly next release we'll fill out most of the feature sets to support PowerShell. and then Azure. And by that, I mean not host integration services running in Azure that we produce at Microsoft and we deliver and support, but rather taking our HIS version 10 Windows server technologies, wrapping them in your own services and deploying them yourselves to Azure. We actually have that working with the SQL Gateway, the Dirta service, and also with Session Integrator and Transaction Integrator, and we'll be looking to roll that out as a bunch of SDK samples in version 10. Okay, with that, we do have one really cool demo, and that's a new technology. It's not quite in beta yet, and it's for the next major release. It's our BizTalk adapter for Informatics. With that, Jorge.
Hello. Can we switch to the other? Okay, here I am. So what I'm going to show you basically is the new Informatics adapter. It's pretty cool, and I'm going to start, just jump right into it and creating a new send port. So now we have a new type of port here that's called the Informatics port. You can configure it here. It looks very much like our DB2 BizTalk adapter, and if you looked at the HIS 2013 version of the product, you'll see that we have new property. This is probably the Paul mentioned, which is the bulk copy. This makes it much faster to upload huge amounts of data into Informix database or a DB2 database, depending on which adapter you're using. And well, the way this works is basically you configure here the adapter, you can create a new connection string or use an existing one. I'm running everything locally here, so that's why my demo is working as opposed to Paul's demo, which relies on the,
you know, the internet. I love these Lenovos they buy for us, but all of my surfaces, which I have four, they all connect to the internet fine. They all connect to my office fine, except this Lenovo, which I never use. Probably I need to use it more often, right? But it failed me today.
No, it's probably the network
here. Should
have
brought one of my surfaces.
Probably the network here.
Uh-huh. It's like the first time in quite a few years my demos haven't worked. I'm not happy.
So basically, yeah, you're going to configure the adapter, okay? Then the next part of the solution would be to go into a BizTalk server project and configure, generate the schema. So we have this wizard here, which is basically using the adapter generate metadata. We can use an Informix adapter here. We choose a port we just created. Say next. We configure some of the stuff here. And we're going to do an update gram to insert like some data into Informix. Goes ahead and runs a schema query so I can pick up which table I want to insert into. I'm going to pick this customer table, and it shows me all the rows of that table. These are going live to Informix. And I check all rows, say next. And this is going to generate me a new orchestration with the port wired and the schema that I need. This is basically the schema that I would be using. I can generate an instance of this schema. That would be what I need to get into that port. Okay. Generate instance. Oh. Anyway, so let's move on to the demo. I actually have some different ports already set up on Wired. And the way this works, I created like two ports. I have my live Informix database here. So right now I'm gonna do, this is the Informix administration, here's my Informix running, it's online. Then I go into this tool, which is very old school, but it's like what Informix admins use because that's the only thing you can run on a Solaris box. And you can look here at the tables, you can say, oh, I want to look at the tables in my stores demo database, I want to look at the info. So we're working with this customer table, we can look at the columns. So it has basically just customer information. And I'm gonna do like a new query and a select count to see how many rows are in my table right now. So now right now I have 10,000 rows. And so I have these ports set up. I have two different ports, two send ports. One of them is, well, I have lots of ports, but two of these are Informix, two of them are pointing locally to my machine, which is this normal port and this bulk copy port. The main difference between these ports is that this one has bulk copy false, and the other one has bulk copy turned on. For the bulk copy, I can select how big my batch will be. So I can select here, I want to send rows 500 at a time. you can tweak these number based on your requirements. Basically, there's a sweet spot where you can get the best throughput. And we're just testing with 10,000 rows right now. I crafted an XML file for these 10,000 rows that we're testing, which is this one. Basically, a bunch of information.
The important thing about the batch size is actually the transaction boundary when we set the commit on the set of rows. So you want to keep it something under 100,000 rows. That's what IBM recommends. Originally, it was the optimal number of rows that fit within a 32K block, because that's what the protocol uses, 32K blocks. But in the current release, we got past that 32K barrier. So you can set it to whatever you want your logical transaction batch size to be.
Basically, to drive these and to like measure the performance improvements, to show you a bit of the bulk copy improvements that we had, I created this sample app. What it basically does, it drops a file into a port, into a receive port that BizTalk is listening to. The send port is subscribed to that receive port, so it'll pick up that file, use the BizTalk adapter to send the rows into Informix, and then it's a solicit response file, so it'll publish a response into another folder. And I'm going to be listening in that folder to see when I get the reply back. Okay, so I'm going to run this example. And the first thing is running bulk copy. So first thing, I delete from the customer table. I deleted 10,000 rows. I would just want to keep some of the first rows because those are dependent. They have dependencies on some other tables. And let's go back here just to check my select count. So we have now 28 rows. If I continue here, it's going to send the rows. It's done. And it took 2.86 seconds to get 10,000 rows from using our BizTalk adapter to Informix using bulk copy. Now we're going to do the same thing, the exact same thing, but without the bulk copy to show the performance improvement. As you can see here, we're waiting longer. We deleted the rows, so we deleted 10,000 rows, the ones we just inserted, and we're inserting another 10,000. So we're still waiting for the file. And another big difference here is that when we use bulk copy, it returns like this XML, which is just says we affected 10,000 rows, as opposed to when using like a single update. It'll return me a response for every row. Since it's executing the individual inserts, it'll acknowledge every single individual insert. And as you can see, it takes like roughly like 3 times longer, and 3 to 4 times longer to do it without the bulk copy. So it's a huge improvement. Remember, this is like pre-beta software, so there's still room for some improvement there. And yeah, that's basically the demo.
Thanks, Jorge. Yeah, there's definitely room for improvement on Formix. This is this is basically DevCo complete alpha code right now. In the DB2 side, though, we're seeing about 10x. That's what our customers are showing. In their environments, and it really depends upon how wide the table is. You know, just a tip, just run batch mode all the time. Even if you're just sending one row, it's faster. It has a lot to do with how IBM implemented the array protocol. They call it multi-dimensional, multi-row input on the back-end system. They did it in a way that is optimized for fetching new rows into the database. And so, however, having said that, you know, IBM has clients for DB2 and Informix. The Informix client they have is very primitive. Configuring the connection is not an easy thing to do. My devs wanted me to remind people of that, or inform you. I think our usability is better because we tend to plumb things better into the Windows environment. But IBM has, for these environments, they've got Java, ODBC, OLADB, Intranet entities, just like we do, although we don't have Java. They don't have BizTalk. So one of our advantages, we have BizTalk. Also one of our advantages is that our core data conversion engine, it's almost the same engine we use across the entire product, is In where it needs to be, it's fully managed, and where it can't be managed, it's unmanaged, of course, but it's faster than anyone else's. We have really, really good code page, custom code page, and machine precision data conversions. And when we access programs on the backend system and files, we do things like occurs depending on overlays and AS400. So those discriminated unions of redefined values, very complex, multi-schema data conversions, and we do it faster than anyone else. So, in fact, it's such a useful technology, there's actually a BizTalk pipeline component that we include as well that just does code page and data conversion at very high speeds. And so if you're using If you need that in BizTalk for something non-IBM, you have that available to you as well.
Thanks, Paul. Can you switch on to the slides?
All right. I was just showing you the
So far we have seen what we have released in BizTalk Server, what is coming up, what is released in HIS, and what's coming up in HIS. What we briefly want to talk about is what's coming up in BizTalk Server 2013 R2, which is the next minor release. It goes back to the major release, minor release cycle, and this is going to be the next version of BizTalk. And as I mentioned earlier, we're planning it in H1 of next year. And the theme, core theme about it is, as with the minor releases, we're going to support the platform updates so that we support all the latest platforms from Windows to Visual Studio to SQL, et cetera. And also we'll be doing message packs, and we release a bunch of CUs, which you talked about earlier. All those fixes and all those functionality will be rolled into 2013 R2. And the major theme, the one theme which we picked for improvements in 2013 R2 is around healthcare and our MLLP space. How many people here are from the healthcare industry? Okay, so if you haven't already talked to Karthik or me, we should probably sync up later during the event. So as part of the healthcare, like some of the key improvements we are making is we are now supporting full 64-bit for MLLP. So this will mean more scale and having the more effective solution. And at the same time, MLLP has been one of those adapters where we really do not have a dynamic adapter support for MLLP. We are getting past it, and the next version will have full support for dynamic MLLP adapter. And we are making the troubleshooting easier. One of the things we have got a lot of feedback on is when people try to troubleshoot MLLP kind of healthcare scenarios, it becomes really complex. So we are doing some improvements around troubleshooting by introducing ETW tracing as well as a few other changes. And in 2013, one of the major platform updates was we support HL 2.5.1. Now, as part of 2013 R2, we'll support HL 7.2.6 support. And we also have, I have not mentioned here, we have a bunch of other incremental fixes which is going into the healthcare space. And together with all these fixes, we believe it packages a bunch of fixes, features, and it enables a sort of some sort of scenarios which will target the healthcare industry. So we're really looking forward through the feedback from folks in the healthcare space. And the other third major theme in which we are going to invest in 2013 R2 is around the adapter improvements. And previously when we talked about what we have heard from you, the slide talking about it, we talked about JSON support, we talked about SFTP, we talked about all the service bus adapter improvements. The ESB part of it was handled as part of the CU releases which we did for 2013. Everything else which you saw is something we are doing as part of 2013 R2. And the major feature which is coming out in the adapter improvement space is the support for JSON, where we want to natively support JSON while exposing resources. Yeah. We are looking into it. So it's either directly we support it or we support service bus on server, which in turn allows us to enable the AMQP support. But either directly or indirectly, we should be able to do that, and we'll go through it. So with this, this is the sort of things which you can expect from a minor release perspective. If you compare and contrast this, yeah, please go ahead. So as part of 2013 R2, it's not. These are the set of changes which is going in. But there's nothing from our end which says that we'll never ever do an ESB token. As part of the major release, when you do a bunch of changes, as we get more feedback, when it's incremental enough, we'll make those changes if necessary. So in this release, it's not. But would like to understand more so that it goes into the major release wave. So, and again, one of the reasons the adapter improvements, this theme makes sense is because initially when we planned, none of this was in the picture, right? And that's when we released 2013, we got a bunch of feedback and that goes back. And so if the Oracle support is big enough, we will go ahead and do it in place. So, all right. So, I don't have a next slide here, but I'm just going to quickly talk through what we think in terms of the major release of BizTalk Server, which is not the 2013 R2, but what comes up beyond it. So, and again, we are very, very early in the planning process where we want to define what themes to target for the major release, and that would be a whole set of more improvements than what you see like this, similar to what you saw in 2013. So one of the help which you require from you is to come back and tell us what you want as part of the major release. It could be in any area. We're not tying to saying that we won't make changes to specific areas. So if you have feedback or feature requirements on, like, say, runtime, BAM, or like schema support, or whatever be it, please feel to reach back to us. That gives us the right set of leverage to understand what the core requirements are and build the right set of things for the product. So with this, I'll open up for questions if you have on BizTalk Server.